Welcome to Midweek Vespers with Trinity Lutheran Church. We're glad that you're with us. This is the second of five Midweek Vespers during the season of Lent. A bulletin to accompany this service can be found on Trinity's website, which is trinitylutheranparkland.org, or on our Facebook page. Again, we're glad you're with us during this Lenten journey. We begin worship by remembering the light of Christ, Christ's presence in our life. The love of God poured into our hearts, the saving grace of Jesus Christ, and the abundant life of the Holy Spirit be with you. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Now is the salvation of our Lord. Turn us again, O God of our salvation, that the light of your face may shine on us. May your justice shine like the sun, and may the poor be lifted up. Thanks, O God, for in the beginning you called light into being, and you set light in the sky to govern night and day. In a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, you led your people into freedom. Enlighten our darkness by the light of your Christ. May your word be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path, for you are merciful and you love your whole creation, and with all your creatures we give you glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
I lift up my eyes to the mountains. From where shall come my help? My help shall come from the Lord. From the Lord.
Our scripture reading this evening comes from select verses of Genesis chapters 7, 8, and 9. It is the well-known story of the flood. I invite you to listen as if this is the first time you've ever heard this story. The Lord said to Noah, "Go into the ark, you and all your household, for I have seen that you alone are righteous before me in this generation. Take with you 7 pairs of all clean animals, the male and its mate, and a pair of the animals that are not clean, the male and its mate, and 7 pairs of the birds of the air also, male and female, to keep their kind alive on the face of all the earth. For in 7 days I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. And every living thing that I have made, I will blot out from the face of the ground." And Noah did all that the Lord had commanded him. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the 2nd month, on the 17th day of the month, on that day, all the fountains of the deep, the great deep, burst forth, and the windows of the heavens were opened. The rain fell on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. On the very same day, Noah with his sons, Shem and Ham and Japheth, and Noah's wife and their 3 wives of his sons, they entered the ark, they and every wild beast of every kind, and all domestic animals of every kind, and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, and every bird of every kind. Every bird, every winged life, creature, they went in the ark with Noah, 2 and 2 of all flesh, in which there was the breath of life. And those that entered, male and female of all flesh, went in as God had commanded him, and the Lord shut him in. The flood continued for 40 days on the earth, and the waters increased and bore up the ark, and it rose high above the earth. The waters swelled and increased greatly on the earth, and the ark floated on the face of the waters. At the end of the 40 days, Noah opened the window of the ark that he had made and sent out a raven. And when it went to and fro until the waters were dried up from the earth, then he sent out the dove from him to see if the waters had subsided from the face of the ground. But the dove found no place to set its foot and returned to him to the ark, for the waters were still on the face of the whole earth. So he put out his hand and took it and brought it into the ark with him. He waited another 7 days, and again he sent out the dove from the ark. And the dove came back to him in the evening, and there in its beak was a freshly plucked olive leaf. So Noah knew that the waters had subsided from the earth. Then he waited another 7 days and sent out the dove, and it did not return to him anymore. In the 601st year, in the 1st month, on the 1st day of the month, the waters were dried up from the earth. And Noah removed the covering of the ark and looked and saw that the face of the ground was drying. In the 2nd month, on the 27th day of the month, the earth was dry. Then God said to Noah, "Go out of the ark, you and your wife, and your sons' wives with you. Bring out with you every living thing that is with you of all flesh, birds and animals, of every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, so that they may abound on the earth and be fruitful and multiply on the earth. So Noah went out, and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth." The word of the Lord. Friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God, our Creator, and from our Savior, Jesus Christ. I find it a gift to revisit these familiar stories from Hebrew scripture during these five midweek Vespers in Lent. Last week, we heard the creation story from Genesis. We encountered through scripture the creating spirit of God that swept over the face of the waters and created all that is, day and night, sea, land, and sky, all the plants and animals of every kind. And then finally, two human beings to live as companions and stewards of the earth. God saw what God had created and called it good, very good, and it was just so until sin entered the world. Though God did not abandon those first humans, disobedience led God to banish them from the garden to a life lived in the full reality of the presence of good and evil. Our scripture reading this evening begins as God is ushering Noah and his family and two of every kind of animal onto the safety of the ark as the floodwaters are coming. Those familiar with this story know that there's an important backstory. The coming flood wasn't a random natural disaster. It was an act of God's own determining. Genesis 6 describes how the heart of God was deeply grieved by the wickedness of the people. God's very being, God's sense of justice, could not abide the corruption wrought by the evil thoughts and inclinations of the human heart. Scripture says God regretted making human beings. God determined to blot it all out, the humans and the animals. But God, noticing Noah and his family and their righteousness, came up with plan B, which is the story we just read. God spared Noah and his family and two of every animal from the waters of the flood. When the dove came back with an olive leaf, they knew the water had receded, and they indeed had been saved. The stunning thing about this story isn't so much that God spared one family and some animals, but that through the waters of the flood, something happened within the life of God. God made a decision. Never again will divine justice take the form of erasing all on the face of the earth. God's justice does not disappear, but God decides that it will be God's mercy, love, and forgiveness that will be God's ultimate response to humans and creation, edging out even justice. As a reminder of this commitment, God hangs up a symbolic weapon of war, the bow. God hangs it in the sky, pointing away from the earth. And God makes a promise, a divine covenant with Noah and his family, but not only with Noah and his family, with all of humanity and all of creation. God's speech is emphatic. This is an everlasting covenant, a covenant with all of creation for all future generations. Now, divine covenants involve a promise and a sign. The promise is never again. The sign is the bow in the sky after the rain falls. In this oft-told story that we tell so frequently as child's play, we hear the profound promise of God, that God chooses relationship over perfect justice. And that changes the whole story, the story of creation, the story of humanity, our story. You see, a covenant is not the same thing as a contract. There are no demands made for mutual fidelity. There are no conditions in which the covenant or relationship is made null and void based on human behavior. God's covenant is not dependent on human will or ability to behave well. And that's a good thing, because before the chapter even ends, Noah's family is already behaving shamefully. This promise, this covenant, isn't about Noah's faithfulness. It is about God's enduring faithfulness and commitment of love and mercy to Noah, to us, to all of creation, for all future generations. This is a fitting story for Lent. From here, we begin to see God's decision and promise take on the shape of a cross, the place where we see most clearly that God refused to meet violence with violence. When faced with injustice and the wicked power of sin, Jesus didn't unleash a torrent of divine power in the form of destruction. Instead, he spoke words of forgiveness. He spoke healing and reconciling words. He trusted the steadfast mercy and love of God was stronger than sin and death, that it was strong enough to redeem all of creation. The bow in the sky points to a creating, covenant-making God. The cross points to the same God at work in the world, faithful to the ancient promises made by God. We are inheritors of God's covenant with Noah. We confess a God who refuses to destroy us or let go of us, God who will go to the cross and be raised again to reveal the depths of God's love and to secure a future for us in the eternal life of God. We hold on to the story of the flood so tightly because it reminds us of the hope we are given in Christ. No matter the storm or pandemic or pain we find ourselves caught in, there is a time after the storm on which we set our eyes, a new tomorrow that is ours as promised in Christ Jesus. May you be blessed during this time of Lent with many signs and remembrances of the love and steadfast mercy of God. Amen. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days, God has spoken to us by the Son.
Renewing Spirit, fill us now.
let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who offer their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the health of the creation, for abundant harvests that all may share, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For public servants, the government, and those who protect us, for those who work to bring peace, justice, healing, and protection in this and every place, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who travel, for those who are sick and suffering, and for those who are in captivity, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For deliverance in the time of affliction, wrath, danger, and need, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all servants of the church, for those who worship this night, and for all people who await from the Lord great and abundant mercy, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Giving thanks for all who have gone before us and are at rest, rejoicing in the communion of all the saints, we commend ourselves, one another, and our whole life to you through Christ our Lord. O God, strength of the powerless and light in all darkness, look in mercy upon your church, a wonderful and sacred mystery, that it may be an ark of peace in the midst of chaos. Let the whole world come to see that what was fallen is being raised up, that what was old is being made new, and that all things are being restored to wholeness through the one from whom they first took being, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. We give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously protected us today. We ask you to forgive us all our sins, where we have done wrong, and graciously to protect us tonight. Into your hands we commend ourselves, our bodies, our souls, and all that is ours. Let your holy angels be with us, so that the wicked foe may have no power over us. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Christ Jesus, dwell in our hearts through faith, as we are being rooted and grounded in love, strengthened by the Spirit, and filled with all the fullness of God. Amen.